Hi class, this is Professor Creek, and in this video we're going to be taking a look at the Quantitative Strategic Planning Matrix, or the QSPM. So this matrix builds on those that we've already learned about, starting with the EFEM and the IFEM and space matrix, and in some cases you can even pull information from the space or the BCG matrices as well. And essentially, what we're doing in a QSPM is we're taking strategies that we've already come up with and we're pitting them against one another and being able to quantitatively determine which of these two strategies is probably better based on the current internal and external environments for the focal firm or for the firm that you're working on. And so the guidelines for how to do one of these are, you start with the same factors that you use in your external and internal factor evaluation matrices. All right, so you can literally take the same factors you had here for the EFEM, take the same factors you had here for the IFEM, throw them into your QSPM, and you're off to the races. Same thing for the weights, right? These can come right from what you've already done in the EFEM and the IFEM. So then in number three, what we're doing is we're taking somewhat of a qualitative approach to this before we move into the quantitative approach. So we can look at which strategies did we come up with in our SWOT matrix. And you could take these strategies together with your group members. And remember, we're simulating here a board of directors and a top management team, right? And you take a look at those strategies and try to determine which of these do we think, just based on discussion, might be the best. And then the QSPM allows us to take that one step forward and go beyond just the qualitative, but then also implement some quantitative rationale for which specific strategy or strategies we're going to choose. So then in step four, we're going to assign attractiveness scores for each factor. So by now, this shouldn't be anything new. We can't duplicate scores. Scores range from 1 to 4, 1 meaning not attractive, 4 meaning highly attractive. And I've got this in bold here. Bold means important. If a factor is not impacted by a strategy, we don't want to assign attractiveness scores. And this is very important. And in some cases, I see where students go awry here because they'll assign an attractiveness score to one strategy and then leave another strategy blank. And that's something you don't want to do. You need to assign an attractiveness score for both strategies or neither strategy, but you never want to assign an attractiveness score to just one. So that's the big one to be aware of. Number five, this should be familiar, right? We're multiplying the attractiveness score times the weight. We sum those up, and whichever has the highest score would be the most desirable strategy. And if you come up with something higher than 8, you better take a closer look because something didn't go right. And so I've got an example in your notes here. You can take a look at this on your own if you want. Just notice that many of these have a dash, right? And if there's a dash for this strategy, which is buy new land and build a larger store, then there also must be a dash here, right? We don't want to assign an attractiveness score to just one and not the other. So essentially, whoever put this QSPM together was saying that this fourth factor, vendors average 6 new products per year, it's not important enough to either of these strategies to include on your QSPM. And so rather than try to talk through it like this, I thought we'd just go through an example. And this is one that I had planned to do with you live in class, but instead we'll just do it right here. And so in this case, we're putting together a QSPM for Green Mountain Coffee Roasters. And this is the company, if you're not aware, that came up with the K-Cup. So that patent has since expired. And as you might imagine, when that patent did expire, it created some big changes for the company. And so a good thing to do would be start the strategic management process, put together a SWOT matrix, and then once you have some strategies in mind, then put together, you know, probably a few of these different QSPMs to compare strategies. So in this case, we're comparing two. Should we, as Green Mountain Coffee Roasters, should we open some new stores in the US, or should we expand into Europe and Asia? Because right now, Green Mountain is only in North America. So where did this come from, right? Where did these two strategies come from? If we back up and go to the SWOT matrix, you can see right here, right? We've got our ST strategies. One of those was to open some retail stores in the US. Another was to enter the European and Asian markets. So if we want to see which of these is better, quantitatively, we just throw them into a QSPM. We then use the same opportunities and the same threats as we had in our SWOT. We can take the weights right from the EFEM and the IFEM. Just note that this is a bit of an abbreviated version, so I don't have all 10 of my opportunities and threats listed. But the weights still do sum up to one, so we're good there. And so what we need to do is assign attractiveness scores for both of these two strategies. So we'll just go down the list here. Opportunity number one, after crude oil, coffee is the most sought after commodity in the world. Is that an important factor when we're considering opening 50 retail stores? Well, probably, yeah, that's pretty good if you're trying to sell coffee. However, it's also good if you're expanding into Europe and Asia as a coffee manufacturer. So I might say that it's important for both, but maybe slightly more important for expansion into Europe and Asia. Over 50% of Americans over 18 drink coffee daily. Certainly that's important if you're doing business in the US, so I'd put a 4 here, but do we care how many Americans are drinking coffee if we're expanding into Europe and Asia? Probably not, so we'd rate that one fairly low. Coffee shops, fast-growing niche restaurant. Notice we're being pretty specific here throughout, lots of percentages, right? However, Green Mountain Coffee Roasters is into retail. Right. If you drive around, you're probably not going to see a Green Mountain Coffee restaurant. Right. They're in grocery stores and things like that. So while this might be important to the industry, it's not as important to Green Mountain Coffee Roasters because they don't do restaurants. And so because of that, I'm just not going to enter an attractiveness score for either of these, right? And remember, if we leave one blank, we have to leave the other blank. So we'll just ignore those because this factor here does not pertain to either of these two strategies. Opportunity number 4, 80% of people in the world drink coffee. Again, that's a pretty important factor, but perhaps it's a bit more important to expansion into Europe and Asia than it would be for opening 50 stores in the US. And then last opportunity, coffee is America's main source of caffeine. All right, we like to stay awake and we do that by drinking coffee. So important for retail stores in the US, maybe less important for expansion into Europe and Asia, again, because we're talking only about America here. So then we move on to our threats. Recently expired K-Cup patent. You see that's a pretty important factor both for Green Mountain and for its competitors, so high weight there, not surprising. attractiveness scores now for opening retail stores. Well, based on that patent, I'd say maybe it's not a good time to open more stores, right? We just lost our bread and butter with the K-Cups. For expansion into Europe and Asia, again, it'd be better if our patent didn't expire. So we'll rate both of those fairly low. So number two here, and actually number four, both talking about Starbucks. Right on, in one case, we have 1.8 billion more cash on hand, and 20% of Starbucks customers are visiting the store more than 15 times monthly. Again, this is more of a restaurant. They do have some retail, but mostly a restaurant. So I'm going to leave both of those blank because they don't really pertain to either of these strategies, at least not very directly. Which leads us to this one. Cafe Nero and Costa Coffee gaining momentum in the UK. I know that's certainly true for Costa. They're all over in the UK. So that would be a big problem for this strategy here. So maybe we'd rate that a one or a two. Less of a big deal if we're opening retail stores in the US, so maybe enter a three there. K-Cups not viewed as being environmentally friendly. This is kind of a gray area. You may argue that it does have a big impact in one of these strategies. I'll take the other route and just leave that one blank as well. So like much of this course, there's some subjectivity. So as long as you can argue why you did or did not assign attractiveness scores, I'll be okay with that. Just remember that if you assign attractiveness score here, you would have to assign it here as well. So now let's move on to the internal strengths and weaknesses. First one here, 30 brands with 200 plus beverage varieties. Certainly those are, that's a good factor for either strategy. Perhaps it's more beneficial to have such diversity in a market you're already doing business in, like the US. And it would be good for expansion as well, though maybe not quite as beneficial. Number two, control 2/3 of the market share of the current K-Cup industry. That's very good for both, perhaps slightly better if we're bringing this to a brand new marketplace. So we might give the edge to expansion. A new partnership with Campbell's for soup K-Cups. That just sounds awful. to me, that sounds awful. I don't think I want to make soup via my coffee maker, but perhaps some people do. You see, it's a fairly low weight, so not that big of an impact to the industry. And so maybe that's important for the US slightly more than expansion. That one would probably take some more research, to be honest. I'm not exactly sure which way that would fall. .45% year-over-year sales growth. That's pretty impressive. And so that would be rated fairly high for both. Perhaps we'd give the edge to retail stores in the US, right? That's something we already know is working. And our sales growth should continue to thrive. Whereas if we take a chance and go over to Europe and Asia, maybe that sales growth isn't quite as impressive over there. Or we might be surprised and it may be consistent or even better. But for now, I'll give the edge to the retail stores in the US. And then our last strength, 96% grocery store presence in the US. Here we might give an edge to Europe and Asia, though this one probably could be argued either way. The reason I went this way is because if we're already in 96% of grocery stores, yes, that's a good thing, obviously, but there's not that much more room for improvement. Whereas if we expand, we have way more new potential customers. So I gave the edge to expansion. And then lastly is the weaknesses, a lack of global distribution footprint. So certainly the strategy most impacted here would be expansion, right? All of a sudden we have all these new customers we can potentially be selling coffee to, whereas less of a impact for the U.S. by far. Liabilities and stockholder equity increased by 13% over last year. So maybe a 3 here and a 1 here. If liabilities are going up, then maybe it's not a good time to make such a drastic strategy as expanding essentially all over the world. Right, so this is probably a bit more safe, and because of that, maybe less of a burden in terms of liabilities, whereas this one would really raise the liabilities potentially quite a bit. Sales of brewer accessories fell 4% over last year, so clearly that's not a good sign. And because we're already doing business in America, perhaps that's part of the reason why brewer sales are going down. But if we get some new people in new markets, we might be able to turn that around. So better for expansion into Europe and Asia. K-Cups not being viewed as environmentally friendly, right? This one similar to this one, so I'm just going to leave that one blank. And lastly is no distribution center in the central U.S. So that's certainly going to hurt if we're trying to open retail stores in the U.S., but not a big deal if we're expanding into Europe and Asia. So at this point, we have all of our attractiveness scores assigned, at least those that we decided to assign. And you'll notice because I'm in Excel, all my math was done for me. So to get this total attractiveness score, right, here's the formula up here. We just multiply the weight times the attractiveness score. And same over here. We just multiply the weight times this attractiveness score. And so we do that for everything. And then we'll sum up the total attractiveness scores for both strategies. Want to sum all of these in Excel, you just hit Control and it'll allow you to only highlight what you want to highlight and then hit Enter. So the score for opening retail stores in the US is a 4.12. Let's see how expansion does in comparison. So 4.59. So we give the edge here to expansion into Europe and Asia. Though these scores are fairly close. Remember, we're going to be somewhere between 0 and 8 here. 8 is the max. So really, these two scores are fairly close. So what might be a good idea at this point is go back to your SWOT matrix and see what other strategies might we want to compare to entering the European and Asian marketplaces. You know, perhaps opening that central distribution center in the US is actually a better strategy. So we might put together an additional QSPM, which compares this strategy versus the expansion strategy. So that's that. You know, I'll make more videos for some future matrices we'll be looking at as well. Let me know if there's something you don't understand in the QSPM or if there's something you think I could be doing better in terms of these videos moving forward.